Okay, now we're ready for Mr. Bell. And Crystal McKinnon, raise your hand, you're ceding your time. Patricia Bell and Kadada Nguyen. Thank you. Okay.
Thank you, Mayor, Council members. I'm here to do two things. One is to update you on Peak and to recognize the people that are here. He was saying that's affiliated with Peak and or the after school program. So the so I'm Gene Bell, and I've spent 32 years here, and about 29 of those about the injustice of black kids. And what I want to do tonight is just give you a brief overview of what's going on, the positive and the negative. But it's important to note that I was on the city, Asheville City School Board for 8 years. I was also a part of two schools, the middle school and Isaac Dixon. Worked very, very hard to have those two schools updated so our kids would get a nice facility to be educated in. So I have to tell you that and talk about the after school program that we have at the Eddington Center that's culminated with what we're doing at Peak. Our kids have to have a place to go. The atrocity is that a lot of black kids suffer by not having babysitters, not having after school, can't pay for after school. All of that just exacerbates the frustration that they have during the day when they're trying to be educated. So I'll talk a little bit about Asheville, and we're still number one in the state for achievement gap. And we're like ninth in the United States for our achievement gap. And for a city that's viewed as one of the most desirable places in the country, that's just not a good thing. And we need to do something about it, and that's what we're here to tell you today. That 15% of third graders at Asheville City Schools show proficiency versus 75% of the white kids. And if that doesn't jerk you in the heart, I don't know what would. And then the same thing, a different number, but the same issue with math. 13% of black kids proficient in math and 80% of white kids. Now, that correlation that 75% of all the people, black people in penitentiary, in the United States are high school dropouts. So this is the feeder source. If we don't do something about the kids, and then they're gonna end up being in penitentiary. Now, if you have invested in privatizing penitentiary, that may be okay, but for the rest of us, it's just horrible that we're losing that many people. Now, the good side, as I mentioned earlier, Peak, 72% of our kids last year tested were proficient in math. Yes. And 44% were proficient in reading. And that deserves a hand, I think. Thank you.
They got you.
I mean, that's significant. So the test scores are just an indicator. But if we don't have an indicator, we can't progress with the educating of our kids. And we've proven that if you focus on kids and focus not only on the academic part, but on the social part, the emotional part, and then progress is being made significantly. And our school director here is the master of that. Ms. Kadada Nguyen has proven that we have to educate the kids in the classroom, but we also have to give them the social needs outside the classroom. And that's obviously where the public school system has failed. And again, I was on the school board for 8 years and we fought this. We went to New York, we brought the KIPP program here, and we were making progress with that. But the one thing that happens with low-income black people is that we can forget about them in a minute. And that's what happened when we had Kip. The only time in the last 30 years that we've had single digits in the achievement gap is when we had Kip. And if you look at our 140 kids, if you take that number and insert that into the public schools, it would have a significant impact on the achievement gap if all of us were in the same school. So the bottom line for us is that we're asking for you all to help us, because we only get half of the funding that the city school system gets in Buncombe County, only half. Now, I'm part of the mistake, and David's here. Where are you?
Yes, sir.
You raise your hand. David's one of the founders, and we thought we were being really, really purposeful when we said we want to feed the kids, we want to give them transportation, we'll feed them twice a day. We want to give them transportation. What we didn't realize was that cost is significant. And it's prohibiting us from doing other things. But as you well know, you can't put kids in an environment and not give them the services that they need for them to be proficient in the academic part. I'll give you a quick story. When my grandson was in the sixth grade, and my daughter was living, she called in a rage, and she got that honest, and said, my grandson told her Jeffrey, his best friend, didn't get dessert. And she said, why? She said, well, he had a red card, and the kids with red cards didn't get dessert. Where our system has layers of who gets what when they get to school. And that's what we negated. We didn't want to do that. So we feed everybody the same meal so that all the kids feel like that they're part of something that's really important, and that is equity. And there's nothing more embarrassing for you to be identified as being different than if you're 5, 6, or 7 years old. And if those of you think back to that time, you can remember. So our economic driver is 93% of our kids, of our scholars, are economically disadvantaged. Say that again, 92%. And approximately 74% reside in subsidized housing. So that's a population that we're all out trying to do something about. And we want you to be a part of correcting an atrocity, a neglect of a population in a city that has more than 80% of the cities in the United States. You know, we're bragging about people moving here, and we're bragging about the price of housing that sold one for $7 million, and we can't feed kids? You gotta think about that. And just because you can't see them doesn't mean that they don't exist. And that's the problem with us as a society, and I'm not just being accusatory to anybody here, but in order to be inclusive, you have to think beyond just the kids. You got to think about you and what would happen if you were one of those kids. And I thought yesterday, what would be better than for us to think about the homeless that we experience and a black 7-year-old black kid that we can't educate because we don't see them and we don't give a damn if they're educated or not. And we just got to stop that. And I'm just begging you today, and I know this is emotional for me, but we can't let a whole segment of the population not get educated. And we're going to make that happen, but we got to have your help. And that's why we're asking for some of the funding that you all have, and I'd like for you to help us with that. And the other thing that we will guarantee you, and Kadada's here, if you want to come out to the school and tour the school, if if you want to see the books, if you want to see the budget, whatever you want to see, we want to be available to let you do that. But you've got to come out and look at it and see the difference. The numbers clearly indicate that we have made significant strides in our method to teach kids that are underprivileged. So that's my ask. That's also my beg and my plea.
Thank you.
That you got to help us.
Thank you. You got a lot. Turn around.
Can I say something really quick since I missed the check-in and we were talking about ARPA funds? I just want to go ahead and say that I would be in favor of utilizing ARPA funds to help fund PEAK.